we'll do one more standard. Let us try and complete AS-05 also. Okay, AS-05, net profit or loss for the period, prior period items and changes in accounting policies. See, basically AS-05 is there to give you disclosures. AS-05 does not actually talk about accounting, it talks about how to disclose those items in your income and expenditure or profit or loss account. Okay, so basically it says that items of income and expenditure differ in their financial implications. Some items are very irregular, some items are regular. Like sale of fixed assets is not a regular item, you don't do it every year. Okay, loss due to fire is a rare item, it might not happen in 10 years, 15 years also. So basis the regularity of item, basis its nature of item, you should categorize those items and disclose in your financial statements or in your income and expenditure account. Now why is that required? Say suppose in the current year I have loss. The loss is because a fire occurred. Now this is not a regular loss. Normally I would make a profit, but because of this fire I am making a loss. Hence you should disclose that loss due to fire separately from all other incomes and expenses. You should show that there is a profit in the current year, then you should show that there is a loss due to fire and the net there is a loss. So that disclosure will help all others to understand your profit and loss account or your working or your operations. That is, you are a profit making entity, but because of this particular loss, which is a rare instance or which is an irregular instance, you are making a loss. So this is what AS-05 says, how to disclose the events. It does not talk about how to account the events. Some can be adjustments due to prior period items. So that also needs to be disclosed separately. Some reflect changes in accounting policies or estimates. So because you have changed the accounting policy, it is affecting your income statement. So you should show that, okay, you should disclose somewhere in your financial statements, whether in notes or somewhere, that this is the impact of change in accounting policy or estimate, and hence my profit and loss or income and expenditure account is adjusted. Financial implications are different for each, like increase in profit due to reduction in expenditure is not same as increase in profit due to change in depreciation method. Hence, it is important to disclose financial implications of these separately or differently. The objective of AS-05 is you should maintain uniformity year on year, prescribe the classification and disclosure, how to classify items, how to disclose each item. AS-05 puts items in 6 broad categories: ordinary but exceptional, extraordinary, prior period, changes in policies and changes in estimates. This standard is mandatory and applies to all enterprises. Okay, what are ordinary activities? Any activity which is undertaken by enterprise as part of its regular business, and such related activities in which the enterprise engages in furtherance of or incidental to arising from these activities. So any ordinary activity which is your business, any items, any expenditure, income related to your ordinary activities are all your ordinary items and should be normally reflected in your income and expenditure account. It should not be highlighted or disclosed separately. It should be kept as normal. Okay, what is exceptional item and what is extraordinary item? Now exceptional item, it says, is ordinary item. See, exceptional and extraordinary, something which is not ordinary is extraordinary. So exceptional has to be ordinary. Exceptional items are normal items, ordinary items, part of your business, but because of its amount or nature, it becomes exceptional. For example, okay, it says an item of income or expense arising out of ordinary activities, but because of its size, nature or incidence, their disclosure is relevant to explain performance of your enterprise, then nature and amount of such items should be disclosed separately. Now what are the examples of exceptional items? Write down of inventories to NRV as well as reversal of such write down. So if you have inventories, those inventories, the value has gone down because of obsolescence or because of some damage to them. Now this is a normal course of business, but the amount may be so material, hence you should disclose them separately if the amount is material. disposal of items of fixed assets. So you have disposed many fixed assets in the current year. Okay, so that becomes an exceptional item. Normally disposal of fixed asset is an ordinary item. I do it every year, or I might do it every second year, third year. But if I dispose many fixed assets in 1 year, the amount might become material. So I should disclose it separately as an exceptional item. Disposal of long-term investments. So I have kept long-term investments, I keep on investing, I keep on selling them. So purchase and sale happens, it is a normal thing for me. But in a particular year, I have disposed all of my long-term investments or majority of my long-term investments. That item I should disclose separately as exceptional item. Any changes in legislature which has retrospective application. So any law change, any regulatory change, retrospective application, and because of that, there is an impact in my current income and expenditure account, and that impact is material, then I should disclose it separately. Any litigation settlements. So there is a case, court case going on against, or I have filed a suit against a party, and that case has settled, so that is a exceptional item, I should disclose it separately. Any reversal of provision which is material. I spoke about ordinary items. I spoke about ordinary items which are exceptional in nature. Now we'll talk about extraordinary items, items which are not ordinary. Now income or expenses which are clearly distinct from your ordinary activities and therefore are not expected to occur frequently or regularly, those items should be classified as extraordinary item and should be disclosed separately. It is determined by nature of the event or transaction as compared to ordinary activities. Frequency is not important. Most important is nature of the activity. Example, earthquake. Now, earthquake, any loss which has happened due to earthquake is an extraordinary item. It is not my ordinary activity. Any loss because of that should be separately disclosed in my income and expenditure account. So how do I prepare my income and expenditure account in this case? So basically I list down my incomes and expenditures. I have a surplus. Then I classify extraordinary items. Then I again list down those items and I write all the expenses and then I again create surplus or deficit. So basically I have to highlight extraordinary items and I have to list down those. This is what I have to do so that I get a proper details of, I get proper idea of the functioning of the institute or the company, whether it is a profit making or whether it is a loss making or whether it has converted into a loss making because of this extraordinary item. So such things I will come to know in this fashion. The nature and amount of each extraordinary item should be separately disclosed in a manner that its impact on current profit or loss can be perceived. Okay. Now these were certain disclosures which I had to make separately, extraordinary items or ordinary items but exceptional in nature. Then there is something called as prior period items. Okay. How do you currently classify prior period items? Where do you show it? Do you show it separately or do you mix in the normal expenses? Separate column for prior period items. So that's what you have to do in future also. That's how this standard says that you have to do. Income or expense which arise in the current period as a result of errors or omissions in preparation of financial statements of one or more prior periods. Okay, prior period items relates to income and expenditure account or balance sheet or both? Prior period items only relate to income and expenditure account. So if there is a error in my depreciation, it is an income and expenditure account, I will go and change it. If it is an error in any calculation of income or expenditure, I will go and change it. Suppose there is a error in calculation of advance received. I received 110 rupees, but I accounted as advance only as 100. It does not go into my P&L. Will I next year show 110 and 10 rupees as prior period item? No. Prior period item is only highlighted in my income and expenditure account. it is never highlighted in my balance sheet. Because it is highlighted only in my income and expenditure account, it relates to only those items which will appear in my income and expenditure account. Clear?
That has not been written off, that goes to the balance sheet.
Sorry?
That is the prior period expenses.
So prior period expenses,
that
expense?
That amount which has not been written off, that goes to the balance sheet.
For example, what?
Suppose you are reaching the share and other things, whatever the prior period expenses, that amount is reapportioned for a number of years. So what amount that is written off in a particular financial year?
Prior period expense, I think you are mistaken. Prior period expense is not that. Prior period expense is?
Pre-incorporation of an organization, whatever expenses that should be.
That is pre-incorporation expense. No. Okay, what is prior period expense? Prior paid error or prior paid expense is expense which was incurred in previous year. I should have recorded in previous year, but I by mistake, by error, I could not record in previous year. In the current year, I come to know that I made an error in previous year, so I record in the current year. And when I record in the current year, I highlight it as it was related to prior period. Hence, it is a prior paid error. What you are talking about is pre-incorporation expense. Before I started my company, I incurred certain expenses. So I will write it off over 5 years or X number of years. So that is completely different. Prior paid error is an error which was conducted by not recording in the previous year, any expense or any income. So prior paid items are items of income or expense which arise as a result of error or omission. So any error I made, any omission I made in the previous year, I will record in the current year. It does not include other adjustments necessitated by circumstances which, though related to prior period, are determined in the current period. Okay, now what this means is, suppose I increase the salary of one of the employees retrospectively, or suppose I bring a new plan retrospectively. So anything which is determined in the current year retrospectively is not a prior period error or omission. I did not know then, how will it be error or omission? Like estimate, I estimated that seven employees will leave my organization, I have to pay them gratuity, I make an estimate. Okay. Now, when I do that, I provide for expenses based on estimate, but say seven did not leave, six left or eight left. It is a change in estimate. It is not prior paid error. I did not know how many will leave. So, something which I did not know cannot be an error. Yes.
A very relevant question I am asking about this. When the pay commission announces its reports and recommendations are accepted in subsequent years, arrears are paid to the employees.
Right.
So, when the arrears are paid to the employees, it pertains to previous years also. Whether
right.
It will be prior paid expenditure.
It is not prior paid because it was not an error in the first place. See, prior paid error or prior paid items are either error or omission. Now, I made a provision of expenses only for what I am paying. Now, at that time, the pay commission had not increased the pay. Hence, I did not know that I will have to pay extra. It is only later that they did retrospectively. So, it is not an error or omission. It is a current period item.
Total expenditure will appear in the
current period. It is not a prior period item.
It pertains to previous year.
Though it pertains to previous year, it is not an error or omission. Because it is not an error or omission, it will not be disclosed as prior period item. Any other questions on prior period errors or items?
I would like to quote one instance. Huh? Say, for example, we have come here to attend this workshop. Then our TA will be paid. So, when it will be booked? When we submit our bills?
Right.
Or when they actually pay after 1 month, 2 months, whatever time.
When you submit your bill, you should create expenditure because you know that it has to be paid. Yeah. So, expenditure has to be created. Yeah. So, you don't have to go by cash basis or payment basis. You have to go by accrual basis. So, you will account for it.
It has already accrued, that means.
Yes.
Because we have come here, it has accrued.
Right, you should account for it immediately.
Okay.
Okay, when it is a prior period item, when you know that it was an error or omission in the previous year, you should disclose the nature and amount in profit and loss account and the impact that will happen, that will that is in the current profit or loss account. Sometimes you can also you know, disclose it within the items itself. Suppose my opening stock is incorrect. Okay, opening stock is a valuation which you do, right? Opening stock, closing stock. Now closing stock is taken forward as opening stock. Say suppose my closing stock was incorrect, hence my opening stock is incorrect. Now there are two options which you can do. It is a prior period error, first of all, because you incorrectly valued it. So you know it is an error or omission and it relates to prior period. So one option is you can go and adjust the opening stock. Other option is you show it separately as prior period error. So these are the two alternatives available with you. Income tax, prior period expenses are disallowed. So any item which you show as prior period expense, income tax will disallow. Any item which you show as prior period income, they will come and tax you.
So loss.
So it is always from the point of view of revenue for them. It should bring in revenue. So expense is disallowed, income is taxed. That is what happens in income tax. Yes.
Sir, we were preparing our annual accounts on cash basis prior to 2004-05 or 2005-06. We started to convert into accrual system in 2005-06, and then we started providing depreciation on the assets from the date of its installation. Now this depreciation pertains to previous years also. Now this is not an error, because only in 2005-06 we started, because it was directed and we started. It was not an error. Now the depreciation for the previous years, whether they are the prior period, though they are not the omissions, neither they are the errors.
Okay. See, there are two more things left in this chapter, which is change in accounting estimates and change in accounting policy. Okay. Now, something which is change in accounting policy, and because of that change in policy, there is an expense or income which is appearing in your accounts because of change in policy. If it is change in policy, then it is not an error. If it is not because of change in policy, then it is an error. So you changed your accounting policy to start depreciating your fixed assets, and hence it will not be constituted as error. It was a basically, but it was a wrong accounting policy. If you have to prepare accounts, accounting standards do not permit cash basis accounting. So you were not following accounting standards at all. If you were following accounting standard, it would be classified as error.
Separately,
you have to account for it in the same financial year, but because it must be very material, you should show it as ordinary but exceptional item, which will appear only in this year. Next year onwards, it will become normal. So you should highlight it as exceptional item. Okay. As I said, we have to discuss two more things: changes in accounting estimates and changes in accounting policy. Okay. Many items of financial statements are estimates, like any provision which you make is an estimate. Depreciation is also an estimate. Okay. An estimate may have to be revised if changes occur. Changes can be regarding circumstances on which estimate is based. It can be result of any further information which you have received. Okay. The revision of estimate does not bring in adjustment within the definition of extraordinary item or prior period item. That means changes in estimates is not a prior period item. It is not an extraordinary item. Changes in estimate is an ordinary item which may happen year on year, every year. It might become a regular item for you. Okay, it has to be accounted for as changes in accounting estimate only. Changes in accounting estimate is not highlighted separately. It is not given under separate header. It is included in your normal expenditure. It is not to be shown separately. It is to be accounted in the period in which the change has occurred, and the period of change and future period, if it affects both, then you have to account for it there. Example, a change in estimate of bad debts. So we were creating 2% bad debts. Now we start creating 3% bad debts, provision for bad debts. So that 3% change you have to directly account as provision for bad debts, 3%, and finish it off. You don't have to highlight that we have changed the estimate. Okay, a change in useful life of depreciable assets affect depreciation in current year and future periods both. If you change, okay, depreciation can change because of change in method. It can change because of change in rate of depreciation. Which amongst this is change in policy and which amongst this is change in estimate? There are two things. Okay, which is a change in policy and which is a change in estimate? Method is policy, rate is estimate. Okay, what is method first? What is method? SLM. This is method. So if you change from SLM to WDV, WDV to SLM, it is a change in accounting policy. Okay. What is rate? Rate is basically you calculate what is the useful life, what is your salvage value. When you estimate useful life and salvage value, that is how you get rate. So rate is a function of useful life and salvage value, and both are estimates. Hence, change in rate is an estimate. So when you change rate of depreciation, you don't highlight it separately. You just change the depreciation amount and you pass a normal accounting entry. You don't disclose it separately. Classified using the same classification. If the item previously classified is extraordinary, if the item itself is extraordinary, then change in estimate is also extraordinary. If the item is ordinary, change in estimate is also ordinary. Okay, accounting policies. Accounting policies are specific accounting principles and the methods of applying those principles in preparation of your financial statements. Okay. Now, why SLM and WDV is method or why it is a policy? We discussed SLM and WDV is a policy. What is the difference between policy and estimate? How do you know it is a policy and not estimate? Sorry?
Policy relates to some rules.
Policy relates to some rules. Yes. Policy is a decision which an organization takes. Estimate is a result of that rules, is a result of that decision. Then I have to estimate basis that decision, how to estimate or how to calculate the amount. So I have decided that I will use SLM. So it's a decision. Whenever it's a decision, it's a policy of the organization. And then when I know it is SLM, I will use my estimates and I will find out the rate. So that is difference between a policy and an estimate. Accounting policies, it says that you have to follow uniform accounting policies so that it is comparable over a period of time to identify trends in financial position, performances and cash flows. As a change in accounting policy is retrospective or prospective? Prospective. As a change in method from SLM to WDV, has anyone done that? Has any institute changed from SLM to WDV till now? Yes.
It is retrospective.
Change in accounting policy per se is prospective. But change in SLM to WDV is given by accounting standard 6 that you have to do it retrospectively. Income tax is not connected with depreciation because income tax depreciation will go on its own. Income tax depreciation will not be dependent upon your books depreciation. Income tax follows only WDV approach. You don't have SLM approach in income tax. So you cannot change from SLM to WDV. There is only one approach. So in income tax, you can never change your accounting policy. Policy in income tax is defined by income tax authority and not by your organization. So you cannot change that. Okay. In books of accounts, you can change policies. change in policy is prospective. Only depreciation is given by AS-06, accounting standard 6, that change in depreciation method from SLM to WDV is retrospective. Otherwise, any other change in policy is also prospective, like change in estimates. A change in accounting policy is allowed only if it is required by any law to change it, or if you want to start complying with accounting standard now and hence you have changed it, or if it is considered that a change will result in appropriate presentation, then and then only you are allowed to change the policy. Whenever you change your policy, you have to give reasons why you have changed your accounting policy. You cannot just keep on changing every year, or you cannot change when you want it. You have to give reasons why I have changed it. Okay. Adoption of an accounting policy for transactions that differ in substance. So there are two basic different transactions. One transaction I have another policy, another transaction I have another policy. This is not change in accounting policy. That's what it says. If you adopt a new policy for a new transaction, a transaction which was not there in your books, you have entered into a new transaction and there is a new policy for that. That is also not a change in accounting policy. Disclosure. Any change in accounting policy which has a material impact, you have to give a disclosure in your notes to accounts. You have to give the impact and the adjustments which are resulting from the change in accounting policy. Where the effect is not ascertainable, you have to disclose that I cannot ascertain the financial impact of change in accounting policy. Where it is not material in the current period, but it is reasonably expected to affect the future periods, then you should give details that this change in accounting policy will affect my future periods. So that disclosure you have to give. See, it says because policy and estimates are so close, okay, it is sometimes very difficult to find or to decide whether this change is change in accounting estimate or whether this change is change in accounting policy. When it is difficult in such case, you have to assume that it is change in accounting estimate and go ahead. Okay, a few questions. A company finds that stocks of 31st March 2010 did not include inventory of 20 lakhs. That means closing stock is wrong by 20 lakhs. How will you deal with this matter in the next year? You will change the opening stock of the current year, or you will write it as prior period item 20 lakhs as expense. Both are allowed. So you can either add 20 lakhs in the opening stock, or alternatively you can show it in P&L as separately as prior period item of 20 lakhs. So we discussed there are five important items. One is exceptional items, which are ordinary but exceptional in the current year. There are extraordinary items which are not ordinary and hence you should disclose it separately. There are prior period items. Prior period items are result of error or omission in the previous year. So you did some error in the previous year. You came to know about it in the current year and hence you should adjust it and show it as prior period item. Then there are changes in accounting estimates. Any change in estimates has to be adjusted in your income and expenditure account. Then there is changes in accounting policies. Accounting policies, any change, you have to disclose it that there is a change, and then you have to apply it in your profit and loss, income and expenditure account. It might even affect your balance sheet, and you have to disclose that you have changed and what is the impact of that change in your income and expenditure account and in your balance sheet. Any questions on AS-4 or AS-5?
Sir, normally prior period income we are showing income side.
Right.
Prior period expenses we are showing
expense side.
Instead of that one, net of the adjustments, whether it is possible, either income is, if it is exceeded income, we are showing income.
See, if prior period income is from some other item and prior period expense is of some other item, then you should not net it off ideally.
Why? Why normally some auditors are asking, since you show the net of adjustments, whether it is income or whether it is expenses side. What is wrong in it?
See, wrong in it is, I will not come to know that there are two items of adjustment. I will think it is only net item of adjustment. I as a reader, see, understand, financial statements are prepared for the reader. Normally, whether the reader is government or the reader is any other authority or the reader is the investor. Financial statements are prepared for them. Now, if there is an error, and error is in expense also and income also, and suppose these are compensating errors, matlab 100 rupees ka expense mein hai, 100 rupees ka income mein hai, so the reader will never come to know that there is a compensating error of 100 rupees each. They will never come to know there is an error in the first case. Hence,
schedules are there.
Schedules must be there, but they, you will then in schedules you will show that there is expense and income both. Then it is allowed. You have to show somewhere that there is a prior paid expense of 100 rupees and prior paid income of 100 rupees. That is the requirement. And then on the header, on the P&L face, you have to show that net prior paid expense is this much. So then it is allowed, but you have to disclose it. That is important. Any other question?
You were explaining that profit or loss on sale of assets. Suppose I follow the net approach and it is shown with 1 rupee. On the asset side and 1 rupee on the liability side also.
Where I have got capital grant?
Yeah.
Okay. Asset I have got grant for fixed asset. Grant I have shown it at nominal value, 1 rupee.
Nominal value, you are showing the asset with 1 rupee and grant also.
Right.
Now the disposal of that asset is there. Suppose the asset is costing 1 lakh rupees.
Haan.
And I dispose it at 60 rupees.
60 rupees.
Because the value in the balance sheet is 1 rupee.
Haan.
And liability also 1 rupee. Now the 60,000 which is coming to me, how to account for that? Because 60,000 become income of the business or what?
Yes, it becomes income. So my accounting entry will be bank account debit 60,000. Bank account or receivable account. Accounts receivable account debit 60,000 rupees. To fixed asset 1 rupee. Or maybe 0 rupee because it is nominal asset and liability goes away. To profit on sale. 59,000 rupees. This is your accounting entry. So this will be shown in your income side.
But is it a revenue income? Because the item is capital in nature and the income will go to the income and expenditure account as revenue.
Yes.
Is it not an error of principle?
It is my income of the current year. I have only income and expenditure account. I cannot directly adjust in my capital reserve.
But on the reverse side, if I follow the gross approach, then 59,000 will not go as an income. Then some other amount will go as an income. Book value minus the realized.
No, if I follow gross approach, suppose in the same scenario, I am following gross approach.
Yes.
Okay, what is the gross approach? My asset, in the gross approach, in my balance sheet, I will have a fixed asset of say 40,000, suppose, example. And on the liability side, I have a grant outstanding or a deferred revenue of 40,000. Now, when I sell this asset, I have to reverse this also. So, when I write here 40,000,
no, it will wipe out this deferred revenue.
I will also write here deferred revenue. So my profit will still be 59,000 or 60,000. 999. Am I right? If I have a deferred revenue expenditure of 40,000, I have a fixed asset of 40,000. My accounting entry will be what? My
and this asset is disposed at 50,000.
Suppose it is disposed at 60, my example is 60, let us take 60,000 rupees. So when I dispose it, it is bank or accounts receivable 60,000 rupees. I reverse this 40,000 rupees. I reverse this 40,000 rupees. So here it is 1 lakh. Here it is 40. So balance 60 will come here, right? So my profit has remained same as 60. See, the logic is, asset to mujhe free mein mila hai. चाहे मैं उसको 60,000 पे दिखाऊं चाहे 40 पे दिखाऊं चाहे 1 रुपए पे दिखाऊं फ्री में मिला है जो चीज फ्री में मिली है वो एसेट लायबिलिटी दोनों साइड दिखेगा जब मैं उसको बेचूंगा तो जितना भी मिला पूरा प्रॉफिट है क्योंकि एसेट तो आइडियली फ्री में है तो अगर मैंने इसको 60,000 में बेचा तो पूरा मेरा प्रॉफिट ही है. सो इवन इफ आई शो 40-40 आई विल रिवर्स बोथ 40. इवन इफ आई शो इट एट 1 रुपी आई विल रिवर्स ओनली 1 रुपी. इट विल नॉट इम्पैक्ट माई प्रॉफिट. आई हैव शोन द अकाउंटिंग एंट्री. यू राइट इट एंड सी आंसर विल बी सेम. जो चीज फ्री में मिला है उसको आप कितने में भी बेचो पूरा प्रॉफिट ही होने वाला है.
It is capital in nature also, the amount which is received.
Part See, I have just income and expenditure account. Income and expenditure account will include all my income of the current year, all my expense of the current year.
Including capital item?
Any item. Even if I sell my long-term investments, my long-term investment is a capital item? जब मैं वो बेचता हूँ, मैं income कहाँ लेके जाता हूँ? Profit and loss. Income and expenditure account. So I don't have income and expenditure account, capital income and expenditure, revenue income and expenditure. I have income and expenditure. It is just that capital expenditure I spread over 5 years, 10 years, 20 years, 30 years. Hence it does not come in the first year itself. So capital income I record immediately because income...
That yes. is whatever is the realization value, that is the total income.
Yes.
That is the income.
Yes. If it is grant, if I have purchased it, then... I have to then calculate the difference of the carrying value and the sale value.
If it is from the project fund, then the method will be different.
Yes. Then I will have some value of fixed asset, net value, yes. So I am considering a case where it is grant. You said it is a grant in the first case. Any other question? Yes, sir.
During previous year, I have shown my income as excess.
Okay.
And this year, I want to report it back. So for that I have to show it as prior period expenditure or
no? But why you want to reverse the income? First of all, you have to give me complete case. Matlab last year I had an income of 100 rupees.
Suppose I presume that from 100 students I will get fees.
Huh.
But afterwards I came to know that out of that 100, 10 students have already left, but for which I had given extra provision made that I am supposed to receive. That I want to reverse it back. So how I will adjust? Whether it will, I will show it as prior period expenditure
all, or? No, first of all, for income, I don't create provision. That means I don't estimate that I will have 100 students and I create income for 100 students. I book income only when I get the money or I know that, okay, 100 students are there. When it is confirmed, I book income. We are following a conservative approach. In conservative approach, income is booked only when we know that it is going to realize. Okay. In any case, suppose it is not students, it is conference fees. Yeah. I have billed them or any other fees, I have billed them. Billed them, book income. Okay. Next year, I come to know that they will not pay me. Then there is a bad debt. It is not a prior paid item. They have not paid me. So, you have to present a good case. I don't know. Explain me what is there in your mind with entire example, then I can tell whether it is prior period or not. Suppose I made a wrong entry. Matlab, only 59 came, only 59 paid me, but I booked 60 income. Now, that is an error. I should have booked for 59, I booked for 60. Next year, I come to know that I have made that error. Then I should show it as prior period error and show it in expenditure account.
Prior period expenditure.
Prior period expenditure. Any other questions? Any other doubts? Break for lunch. Thank you so much.